Dire team ban. Vega squadrons, turn to ban. Dire team pick. Seconds remaining.
Dark Seer.
Vega squadrons turn to pick. Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
Gyrocopter!
Vega squadrons turn to pick.
Dusker!
Dire team pick.
Night Stalker.
Dire team ban. Vega squadrons turn to ban. Dire team ban. Vega squadrons turn to ban.
Hyper.
Dire team pick. Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Witch Doctor!
Vega squadrons turn to pick. Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
clockwork.
Dire team pick.
Behold the horn of Magnus.
Vega squadrons turn to ban. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Vega squadrons turn to pick. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve
Disruptor.
Time. Dire team pick.
Anti-mage.
I hope you guys can hear me. Thank you, panel. Hopefully, if you guys can hear me, I'm going to be going into, I think Vega probably want to think this is game one, because that first game was, it's probably better if we all just forget about that. But this is actually going to be game two for Clovers, with a game lead, are going to be going up against Vega. Lower bracket, finals, winner of this goes up against Empire in a non-advantaged best of five. A non-advantaged is a term that people understand. Vega, they really switch things up here. This is a lot of classic Vega heroes. Got Mag on his trademark Clockwork. Pasha's back on the Gyrocopter. You have Solo actually playing the Tusk. I kind of expect to see someone take that, but really, I think their hero roles are kind of interchangeable, and I got no one, of course, on his Viper. But other than that, Four Clovers, they're also switching gears almost as much as Vega are.
Yeah, I mean, they ran this yesterday, Bambo, with the Magnus towards the mid lane, and they're pretty fluid in terms of their actual player to lane matchup. So I feel like this is still comfort zone for Bambo and his squad. Sax on the Nightstalker, certainly very nice. Niko's played the Darkseer almost the entire tournament thus far. EGM, second game in a row on the Witch Doctor, and yeah, Pycat gonna pick up the end image. So really love 4CL's draft here. Feels like it fits both what they're trying to do and counters Vega. I feel like Vega were kind of cornered in with that Disruptor last pick. They didn't really have anything to deal with this Anti-Mage in terms of Disable and Silence prior to that. But with that Disruptor pickup, feels like they're a bit weak in lanes aside from the Viper in the mid.
Yeah, Disruptor definitely here that you want to have up against an Anti-Mage, as far as controlling him and killing him off aggressively, that is. So, retroactively, it does make the Disruptor a little bit of a better pick up against Four Clover's last pick, Anti-Mage, but this is going to be an Anti-Mage game, first of all, an Anti-Mage game with Magnus in power. Like, we were just sitting here listing off heroes that four Clovers can possibly pick up in order to really abuse that empower. And we haven't actually seen that much Anti-Mage in this tournament. And I think we've seen like one, maybe, and it lost. Yeah, like, I want to say if we did see any, it's probably zero, and if we saw it, it didn't do well. So, Anti-Mage already not off to at least the start that PyCat really wants. Nowhere near the start of last game. Forces teleport down to the bottom lane, where four Clovers were going to run this Nightstalker, Darkseer dual lane, a lane with the intent of applying a lot of pressure, but going up against a Clockwork with that lane is almost impossible, because if you get close, he just cogs you out.
Indeed, but Anti-Mage is one of the better melee heroes against the Clockwork if he's able to burn his mana. He does have a very small mana pool, so look for a couple early points into the mana break for PyCat. And if he has Saxa down here early on, he'll be just fine to find his CS.
Well, of course, they do rotate the Darkseer up towards top. EGM looks like he's going to hang around still up towards top and bottom lane. They'll jump in towards Mag, bypass his cogs, put a lot of very easy damage on him. Unfortunately, level 1 Anti-Mage is not a good hero, so it doesn't actually do that much. Mana Break being leveled up with Blink there would have just destroyed Mag's lane, or would have made it a lot worse for him either way. We have ourselves a dual lane top for 4 Clovers going up against 3 for Vega. This actually seems pretty decent for 4 Clovers. Like, yeah. Equal on the Darkseer, unless you get hit with a Shockwave and an Ice Shards at the same time. The Ice Shards should, or the Ion Shell rather, should keep everyone from Vega at arm's length.
Yeah, it doesn't feel like there's too much kill potential from Vega unless there's a misstep from Niqua and Saxa, or Niqua and EGM, excuse me, but the dual lane should fare just fine, and maybe look for Vega to rotate someone around and find an advantage elsewhere on the map. For now, Solo is going to return to this top lane on his Tusk. Bottom lane, Mag, being encroached upon, the Void is going to be popped there, and he does no longer have enough for the cogs, but PyCat not going to chase underneath that tower, going to back off, retreat and find some CS. Meanwhile, top lane, EGM stuck in the kinetic field, is going to get a nicely bouncing cask off. The shards will be there, Surge is there as well. Solo, not level 2 yet, so EGM will be fine. He does get his self cancelled, however, which is unfortunate to say the least.
Oh, field is right on the edge.
Yeah, that'll run this kinetic field, so probably run, dead EGM. Here. First blood, good start for Vega after much less than that in game one.
They have one kill.
Mag
is about what they ended up.
Bot lane.
No, I doubt it. Mag never dies. He doesn't have cogs though, so there's a very high chance that he may get jumped.
Yeah.
And if they just blink in for the mango, that's a huge trade for 4 Clovers in and of itself. They will swap the lanes around, leave the Darkseer up towards top by himself, and just have the full two supports down here chilling with one another.
It's daytime, so I think Mag sees EGM rotate in here, and yeah, he's walking the base.
It's also almost nighttime, so you rotate the support down to give PyCat continued farm, and that lets Saxa leave the lane and maybe apply a little pressure to the Viper. It was, you know, doing quite well in this mid lane, about as well as you would expect versus the Magnus matchup. A very easy one for the Viper, but you know, once you add a Witch Doctor and a Night Stalker coming in, it's very difficult to kill off the Viper, but it is possible, and it is something that 4 Clovers should be looking to do with their support. They don't want to be sitting back doing nothing while their Anti-Mage farms. They want to be trying to, you know, throw a wrench in the Vega's plans.
Yeah, Vega will get really strong around that early mid-game mark, somewhere around 12 minutes. So they definitely want to try and create some space and shut down at least some of these supports and deny their levels away from them, because once they pick up that Static Storm and the Walrus Punch, they can certainly start to apply some pressure to 4CL's side. But for now, they're going to rotate Pasha back down to the bot lane alongside Seema. And still no real kill potential here in this lane just yet. And Bamboo is going to rotate down with a Haste Rune level 4, 2 points in that skewer.
Oh shit, this could be pretty bad for Vega.
A little bit far forward, Bamboo actually going to scout them out and back off, so going to return back to his lane for now. Deep lane ward from the Radiant, provide any vision from the TP's in. So, it looks like Pasha's feeling pretty safe.
Not about getting kills, it's about sending a message, and looks like the message was not pretty well received here from the Vegas side. They're just gonna chill in lane, no big deal, and actually force PyCat to leave, and we have teleport shuffles all over the freaking place. They really just want PyCat to go up against the Clockwork. Like, that matchup is just so good for the Anti-Mage, at least as good as it can be versus the Clockwork. Jump in onto Mag, double Ion Shells are there. The matchup Darkseer versus Clockwork, I mean, it isn't bad for Darkseer, but it's definitely one of the lanes where Darkseer has to be a little bit more careful, especially 1v1 melee, where usually Darkseer is going to stomp.
PyCat rotated back up to that top lane, and it was a pretty convenient timing for him as well, as Solo did it in bottom, so a little bit of wasted time for Vega side, and EGM playing very safe, just trying to soak some experience in this lane. Shards should be able to catch him. You're actually going to bounce him out to the east. That's going to be a little bit favorable for 4CL. They throw down the Kinetic Field, but with the Night Stalker nearby, it's really not a situation where they want to dive. The cast is going to go out. Seema sitting on 50% HP. A couple right clicks will finish him off. Oh, cast is going to bounce nicely, but yeah, Stocks are going to be zoned out by the Gyrocopter, doing a little bit too much damage this early stage in the game. And we'll pick up that third level in the Rocket Barrage. TP's down now from Niqua. Has the Surge available, but he'll be scouted by the Wave. I kept by his lonesome top lane up against Mag. Should be doing just fine. Meanwhile, though, Bembo having a little bit of rough time in the mid lane. 35 CS to no one, 19 to Bembo on the Magnus, as you would expect in this matchup.
Yeah, as long as Bembo has mana for a skewer, and he always should have mana for a skewer, there's a very low chance that no one is going to solo kill this Magnus. Really will need someone like a Clockwork or a Tusk to come and help him out just to prevent that skewer from happening. But otherwise, Bembo still is going to be dropping very low from the constant harassment.
He does have RP now, and the rune is spawning. He's going to be able to pick that up. So, perhaps they make a play off the back of that. They have a couple of deep wards here in the bottom hemisphere of the map. So, they're pretty well aware of the positioning of the carry and his supports behind him. Saxa's going to find Solo. He gets the Crippling Fear off. It's nighttime. This is going to be a dead Tusk. The Glimpse comes back. And Solo's going to be okay.
Probably 30 still
HP.
Dead.
Niqua going to rotate in. The Snowball comes through. Niqua taking a bunch of damage from the Rocket Barrage. But Solo should be falling here. Saxa will be able to chase him down. He does have to expend the Void, however. So it allows Pasha to start to chase far forward, but they're going to be able to rotate out. It's a pretty heavy commitment, excuse me, for Solo bot lane, but at least 4CL don't lose much, and their anti-mage is farming.
A little bit of heavier commitment from Niqua, who just ran straight through, didn't really do anything there except for absorb rockets from the Gyrocopter. That being said, you find a Tusk like that, it's nighttime, and you have a Darkseer behind you, you have the stuns. Okay, my bad, guys. You know, I literally just said, no one should be able to get the kill on Magnus unless someone like Tusk comes in to help out. And, well, I probably should have been listening to myself.
Viper Strike utilized. Level 8 now onto Solo. And looking really good in terms of both net worth and CS. Still though, I mean, he's gonna have that early mech and they certainly can fight around it with the cooldown and all the utility offered from the Disruptor and the Tusk, but 4CL are decent at dodging fights. They've got the Surge, they've got the Skewer, they've got a quick Night Stalker and the Anti-Mage, so maybe they give up a couple of Tier 1s and look for trades elsewhere in terms of the pickoffs with this Magnus, but actually RP was utilized mid lane, so it feels like he used that before dying, Bambo.
Oh, bottom.
Down. Yeah, it's going to be dropped, and Niqua is pretty much dead to rights here. He is going to drop the wall, though. Gyrocopter Illusion, maybe enough to bring Pasha down here, but
the creeps.
Yeah, he's going to be able to
the
just
creeps,
outrun
3
it.
HP. Cask, it's going to throw, that's going to get the kill. However, now EGM is stuck in the static in the field, and he will fall to Mag. Coast shot was used kind of awkwardly there, but either way, yeah, it is worth it. Clutch kill almost got away there.
Obviously, they take the less favorable trade, losing a core and a support for a core, but certainly worth it for EGM to make that play.
Mm-hmm. And for Mag, I mean, you're level 6 Clockwork. That's never really the time where you want to roam away. It's the time where you can roam away, but ideally you want to have level 8 or 9 before you actually leave the lanes and look to, you know, rotate around, get those hookshot ganks off. So kind of getting thrown a free amount of experience there, Mag, and he's going to find himself in a lane where he kind of wants to be. I mean, with hookshot, but yeah, the Anti-Mage right now doesn't actually have any opposition.
I was going to say, how do you feel about the lack of respect, essentially, for the Anti-Mage and Pycat in this one? I mean, this is the first time they paid him any attention in the game, and no one is pretty much by his lonesome here. Zambo comes in, he has RP available if need. He's going to catch it onto two. No one's still very tanky, four levels and curls.
Oh, did he dodge?
Yeah, they're not. They're going to get the Mana Void off. Bambo is probably... Oh, actually, he gets the bottle off and the Voodoo Restoration there, so... Yeah, I mean, the first time they rotate to this top lane, it's in a few numbers, and 4CL make them pay.
Did Viper just not take any damage from that because of Corrosive Skin and high mana, or did they actually... Can you actually dodge that? I don't think you can. I don't know if you can with Snowball, but either way, you find yourself in a situation where you're vastly outnumbered like that for Vega, and well, they lose their Viper, they lose a couple heroes there, and Magnus, of course, did expend his RP, but... They are really not respecting Pycat all that much. As far as pressure being applied, they're kind of forcing him to teleport around, try and find the ideal lane, try to find the ideal place to farm, but they're not really trying to kill him, and
I mean,
that's what you gotta do.
Him, so he's
level 1 right now. Yeah,
I mean, he's really, I mean, just in the game in general, he's not worried about having to rotate too much because he'll recover and farm when the time comes. And yeah, he's already got a Perseverance up. has enough for it, at least on top of the hatchet. So just a couple of swords away from that battle fury, and all things considered, him being the weak laner that he is, Pycat's just fine where he's sitting right now. And Vega haven't established enough of an advantage elsewhere.
Mag, he has a flare. Scouting will find nothing. The creep wave will be drawn up. They will run into Pycat. He'll blink right to the south. Kioma's gonna bring him right to the north. Snowball will connect for the stun, but Pycat now very far away. Has another blink in 2 seconds. He's gonna get hookshot. Cogs need to bump him back. He will blink out, and he should be just fine. Niqua, who almost caught in the field, will be fine as well.
That glimpse actually hurts them.
Yeah, a lot.
Solo is completely out of position then to contribute. I mean, he's on level 6, so perhaps you could argue that he had nothing left other than the snowball shard combo, but yeah, I mean, the glimpse kind of brought Pycat into a favorable position. And yeah, we mentioned in the draft, if they don't have a static storm, they do not kill the Animage. Disruptor level 5, Tusk level 5, it's just fine for the Dire side. They've got a level 5 Nightstalker, level 6 EGM Witch Doctor, so Vega haven't really found a great advantage at this point. I mean, both the leads in terms of the metrics are sub 1,000 at this point.
Now they're going to claim a tower over in mid, so 4 Clovers. I mean, they do eventually make a tower trade, but this is Vega pushing. It's going to take a very, very long time, but as 4 Clovers, they kind of had a head start. They're going to set up for bottom lane. Saxa is going to get with the shards. Calldown is there as well. Sax is going to silence Pasha. Gets Walrus Punch for his Trouble Tower. Still taking a lot of damage. Is going to stick up. Cast is going to come in. This time not really bouncing perfectly, but it seems like it doesn't really matter because here comes Bambo. Will completely botch Skewer. Is going to deploy the RP onto Pasha right now. Another Void is here from Saxa with the Death Ward. Pasha is going to fall. EGM also getting a full channel of that Death Ward, but they do take down the Dark Shadow up towards top, however, without using Hookshot. Somehow, so Solo not out of the woods just yet. Pycat right on his ass. There's a mana void, won't quite do enough. Shockwave will miss, and Pycat doesn't really want to go into that corner without enough mana to blink out. Bambo now stuck in the cogs, has to dig his way out. He will get a little bit out. No one now trapped by the cogs also has to dig his way out, as Bambo looking for the skewer out is going to bring Mag with him. That means he can't blink. He's got to blink soon, but no, he gets canceled by the Viper. He'll fall. That's unfortunate.
Yeah, and they'll feed over Bambo there. Pycat's still safe at this point. It's a loss for 4CL, but they're not too worried about giving it up. I mean, they've found levels elsewhere. They're still, Vega's still unable to take objectives off the back of this, and that's perhaps partly but by virtue of picking a clockwork. He's not great at pushing towers. But it still feels like 4CL are communicating well, like we saw them do yesterday against Vega. And I mean, they look strong, and they're keeping their objectives alive. They're keeping enough map control for the anti-mage to continue farming. Bambo's creating space, although dying. They have the mech on Niqua now. Saxa with a beautiful play on the gyrocopter after taking the initial column down, ensuring that he has no more damage to contribute, and the innate tankiness of the Nightstalker allows them to turn that fight pretty well. Vega will now look to finally address the issue of objectives and map control. I mean, this tower itself not holding much map control, but at least they'll be able to remove one of these structures off the map.
This draft and game plan from Vega is very similar to the supposed game plan from 4 Clovers in Game 1, in that they're just supposed to, you know, get their items up, namely this mech. Obviously, they didn't have quite as much as 4 Clovers did, but after that, just go and get these towers and then look to rotate around consistently, because their peak in this game is right about now. Yeah, Gyrocopter and Viper do scale pretty decently, but nowhere near compared to that of an Anti-Mage with the Magnus behind him. That you cannot compare those two.
Late game is certainly in the hands of 4CL.
So they got to go right now. They got to go really hard, and they also need to not get jumped right now by EGM and Invis Rune, giving perfect vision here to 4 Clovers. They see no one. There is a blink skewer and an RP. They know that Mag Clock can help out.
They can block the hookshot with Saxa. Yeah, he's going to go in, find the Crippling Fear. They're probably going to initiate here onto no one. They get the Death Ward down. He's going to mech early. They get the Shockwave. The Glimpse back is onto Saxa, but that's just fine. They'll skewer back no one. Death Ward channels full duration. Saxa is going to fall here. And the Walrus Punch does come through. Niko in a little bit of trouble. Nice cast from EGM. He'll be able to surge out. Hookshot is going to be well wayward coming out from Mag. And one for one trade. Nice talker for Viper. When you have an anti-mage at 14 minutes in, 4CL will take that every day of the week.
Oh yeah, you're ecstatic to make that trade. It did cost you a couple of ultimates. I mean, you did eventually have to use the RP and the Death Ward. And I mean, that is kind of a cost associated with that kill. But for Vega, they need to be a little bit more assertive than this. They had their entire team there, and Pycat was just chilling up towards top lane. His second sword should be on the way very soon. So Battle Fury, for the most part, completed. But even then, like, Battle Fury timings in this game with with the Magnus, not as important as usual when you're going without that mag. So more Clovers sacrifice their Nightstalker for the greater good, and as long as they can keep those kills, especially on a hero like Viper, who is actually like the most important hero for Vega right now, then their towers are going to survive for that much longer.
Yeah, I mean, we touched upon it earlier. It just doesn't feel like this Viper utilizes no one's skill set to his full potential. He's such a good player mechanically and really smart in terms of being able to get himself out of engagements. And I mean, the whole purpose of this hero is to stand on the front lines and tank everything and do damage with his passive as well as with his right click. And yeah, I mean, with him down, they're unable to push towers, so Vega, as he responds, will go right back to it.
Shot. They got EGM right now. Shards should snag this kill, and it will secure the kill for Mag.
It's a nice
also
kill.
Looking for Bambo right now. There's a short glimpse. He can't get the skewer out, and he will go down eventually. Stuck in the field, Static Storm. He'll get mech and stick, but there's no escaping that. Yeah, Disruptor is going to claim the kill. Two kills for the Vega squadron side. That's good, and they need to keep that up. If they keep doing that, then they could effectively pressure the Antimage by denying him space to farm. But again, Antimage is on top.
He has a Battle Fury.
And he's probably going to claim this tower in the next creep wave.
It's just out of deny range at this point. And yeah, Vega finally doing what their lineup is intended to, put that Viper on the front line, push the structures, force them to come to you with a fight, and utilize all your really good team fight abilities in terms of the ultimates, at least with the call down in the Static Storm. And they're able to farm Pasha in the meantime, so it kind of benefits them all around in that small window. But bot lane, speaking of Pasha, Darkness going to be popped up. He's going to get Crippling Fear. The cooldown will come out, and Pycat, for that reason, is going to back off. But they're at least going to pressure the Gyrocopter. They don't expend too much. I mean, Darkness, sure, it's a fairly long cooldown at level 1, sitting on 160 seconds, but they're not too worried about giving that up as long as they're able to create space. And they've been really good with deep warding. See one by the mid lane, and now another one going to be dropped at the bot lane. So going to keep them safe for Pycat to be able to farm the opposite side of the map.
Yeah, you don't get the kill, but you trade the Darkness for a tower, which for four Clovers is probably better, in fact. Just keeping Vega away from teleportation spots means that next time they go for that Gyrocopter, no cancel TP is going to be coming in from the Vega side. And you know, Pycat can now farm a little bit more aggressively in the enemy woods, so he'll be able to just get so much more potential income with so many more options. Eventually, when he gets his Vlads, and I suspect he will be building Vlads with his headdress because, you know, Mechanism Anti-Mage isn't really a
EGM's
thing. Then they
can
go for Roche, and yeah, EGM. Smoke broken now on Vega. He's going to throw a cast. Will not bounce a single time. Feels bad, man. RP only onto Pasha right now. They'll drop the wall onto Pasha. However, the Static Storm is going to be there in response. Bambo going to take a hell of a lot of damage. Seeing that Static Storm will fall. EGM still channeling up his full Death Ward. However, it's not in the perfect position right now. They'll pick off Solo, but now Hookshot onto EGM's Mag is right on top of him with the Cogs. Battery Salt is there as well. The Heal from Witch Doctor doing some work, but not quite enough as Mag is going to lose his Cogs right now. EGM is going to actually walk away. Sax is going to try to teleport out of here.
So
and it looks
smart.
Like he'll get away. EGM. Is he really gonna live through this? Mag has another flare that will not kill.
Yeah.
EGM's fine, it's a 2-for-1 trade. Not a great trade for
That's
four Clovers.
Huge for four Clovers, considering that they only have four people there.
Yes.
Probably a little bit less than they would have expected, having pretty much complete vision of the entire team, but when you have the RP essentially whiff like it did from Bambo, and that is a bit of an anomaly, we usually see him land those, you do expect that fight to go much worse. So not terrible for them. Pycat's still farming, we'll have the Vlad soon, probably does have it flying out now, full Vladimir's flying out, so he's essentially fight ready at this point, does want a few more items, at least a Manta at this point, to continue on fighting. But Pycat feeling good, and as his entire squad still with all their tier 2 standing, still no Roshan conceded to the other side. So Vega, I mean, they have an advantage, but I mean, is it really one that they desire at this point? It's not nearly enough for CL to feel behind.
Yeah, I mean, they need to start cracking into these tier 2s, like, very, very soon. Yeah. Otherwise, this Anti-Mage is going to be fight-ready pretty darn fast. He already has the Vlads, and I was mentioning that Vlads opens up the door for Roshan, at least makes it so that it's a lot less risky for the 4 Clover side. And then for Vega, if 4 Clovers are able to grab that Aegis, they probably can still push. I mean, they really want to still push, but they really can't do it safely. So just grabbing an Aegis for 4 Clovers may just mean that they are completely safe. Their base structures are not going to die for however long, and now Solo going to find EGM. Shards will throw, and there's a hook shot here as well. If they find an angle, Water Punch is there first. Now EGM's going to get glimpsed back. Poor guy, man. Can't catch a break. His casts, though, have been pretty darn good. Of course, there's all skill, but Witch Doctor this time is going to fall. But again, Witch Doctor, for a little bit of space for your anti-mage, that's kind of worth it as long as they don't give up Roshan to Vega.
Yeah, it's wise for it's wise as well for Meg to be able to hold on to the hookshot there, and they will be able to clean up these ancients with the Black Cannon, so that's a pretty big hit towards the 4CL side. And this is what Vega needs to be doing. I felt like taking out the mid tier 1 and the bottom lane tier 1 was really, really helpful for 4CL after they lose that engagement bottom, because with RP down for Vega, you probably want to TP and go right for Roshan. But they'll smoke up instead, which is a similar play, looking to assert their advantage. And they will find both that stack and a kill. Now RP back online, though, it's going to be tough for them to be able to push into these structures. A lot of deep vision, though, planted as well for the Radiant side. So going to have eyes on PyCat. At least as he rotates down to that ancient stack.
I believe the gyrocopter also, before he stole that stack, also cleared off his own stack, which was triple stacked. So suddenly six ancient camps being into the pockets of the gyrocopter. Gonna grab a mithril hammer. So Maelstrom definitely incoming now. It's gonna be probably BKB for the gyro. Just looking to bust up that high ground ASAP. BKB, that is an item worth waiting for. And by that time, it should also be Vega looking for some way to get into the Roshan pit and being able to take that one safely. It probably will hinge upon a smoke beforehand, but four clovers, I think they're okay in this game. Like, those past couple of engagements, in and of itself, like, those weren't great for them. But in the grand scheme of anti-mage, those fights are okay to lose.
Indeed. So at this point, it feels like Vega are a bit too stagnant. And I mean, that's just the virtue of the 4CL draft. You draft this Magnus Darkseer around your anti-mage, and it still feels tough to push into, despite you having a Viper and a Clockwork, which are naturally aggressive heroes that want to be on the front line taking engagements over and over their low cooldown. But they've been unable to break 4CL's defensive lines thus far, and PyCat continuing to split B bot lane. They do have a Radiant ward, or a Dire ward mid lane, that's going to scout out Mag, and they're going to find the RP onto Sioma. They're going to get him back out of range of his teammates, and the glimpse back will not save him here. The kinetic field's going to trap three, but they don't have any follow-up, and PyCat, for that reason, has to back out of the top lane. But they get a pick, they'll rotate down PyCat to the bot lane. He's got enough with his Vlads for an ultimate orb or Yasha. We'll be able to bring that out soon.
Is the kill on the disruptor good enough to go into the Roche pit? It seems like it might be, but they're not going to risk it.
Yeah, just the respawn timers are a bit low, but without the tier 1s, if they were very quick about it, there was a chance they could have gone for it.
Well, it is either way not going to be attempted. The hero will be up in just another 5 seconds, whereas the RP that was expended to kill the hero, not up for another 75 now. So this is a slight opening for Vega should they want to make a play within the Roshan or towards those tier 2s. Sitting around and doing nothing, definitely not the way that Vega win this game. So it is up to them to be super assertive. It seems like it is going to be straight down the mid lane. Now, there may not be an RP for Clovers. However, what they do have is a Blink Dagger on the Darkseer eventually when it gets out here with the, I guess, level only one wall. It's kind of unfortunate, but they have a wall vacuum combo, and they have to deal with PyCat split pushing down towards bottom. So going for a straight push like this may be successful in that Vega will take down the tower for Clovers, but they'll lose just as much as they gain, and that's perfectly fine for the Clovers.
Yeah, they're more than willing to give this tower up. Interesting pickup as well. The Night Hunter goes for a gem, is able to D-ward around the ancients.
And he's going to get glimpsed back really short. He's going to put into the stack storm right now. However, there is help right around the corner. Calldown is coming. PyCat needs a blink out. Right now, he can't quite get it. He gets the tower, but he loses his life for it. Flare firing forward. Mag is going to land the hook shot as you would expect. Snowball's going to come in and plow down the Nightstalker. It's two kills for Vega, and that is probably good enough to go into Roche.
Yeah, more than likely, they'll be able to take Roche on here. And I was just going to touch upon how Saxa picks up a gem to do a little bit of the dewarding on the Eastern Hemisphere, the Northeastern Hemisphere, but he smartly drops it off on the Courier before the fight, and they will not lose it. However, they do get that tier 2 bot lane, so it's not a completely horrendous trade, but with this Roshan, now you feel like Vega can jump into these ultimates from 4CL side and continue to take structures with that extra life.
That play only really happens because Vega know that they sacrificed Sioma so that they could pull the RP out from the Magnus. That was the trade, and that was the trade that 4 Clovers in a vacuum again should have been happy with, but in the grand scheme of things, this one not really quite working out for them. This is something that Vega absolutely needed. They, again, gave the Aegis to 4 Clovers. Their game plan completely grinds to a halt, and if their game plan grinds to a halt, they probably end up losing, I want to say, if they end up giving the first Aegis away to the 4 Clover side. But now that they have this double life, they did expend the first BKB charge on the gyrocopter, which is unfortunate, but they'll be able to go straight into those other tier 2s, since they actually didn't finish off the tier 2 mid lane. That should be easy pickings for them. and they should be rotating around to the other tier 2s as long as they have this double life.
Yeah, they have no time to waste. They've got a 10-second BKB up on, oh, it's 9 seconds now, excuse me, up on Pasha, and they've got the Aegis as well on their gyrocopter. They've got no one. Pretty much tanky is going to get for the next little bit. Sitting on 2,300 gold as well. But maybe building into a Manta for this Night Stalker silence feels very odd. See the Viper build into
this is a high ground siege item, and that's like kind of the game plan for Vega. So I can understand that. Also, getting rid of Crippling Fear is a substantial bonus, dude. Crippling Fear is OP as hell. Have you seen that skill?
I guess
skill's
Viper?
Broken. Versus anyone, man. Glimpse back is gonna catch PyCat, it seems. There is no RP. Real good angle here for Bambo. PyCat taking a lot of damage right now. He'll get out of the Static Storm. Blink away is available. He can't get it off. They'll take down the Anti-Mage. Where the hell did Bambo go? It seems like he teleported out. EGM gonna try to do the same. Hookshot, shards, anything. No. But it's not gonna lash, but still, they take down the Anti-Mage. Minor amounts of split push. The tower in the mid lane still drops. They want to be doing that every day of the week.
Yeah, they do want to be killing this Anti-Mage as much as humanly possible, but it still feels like they're not going to take objectives off this Aegis with them having to back to base. So to some extent, it feels like 4CL have accomplished what they want to do. They want to be able to create space and force TP rotations back. Of course, the trade for it, you want to give away your supports, give away a Night Stalker, a Witch Doctor, maybe Darkseer or a Magnus, but PyCat's certainly not the hero you want to lose in that scenario. But however, they do keep the lanes pushed out and maybe just lose a tier 2 off of this. I mean, PyCat's going to be up in 10 seconds. They have all their ultimates, so they can still mount the defense. Nico's gonna shove in bot lane in the meantime, so 4CL are playing this exactly as they need to at this point. We already alluded to the fact that late into the game, they got more or less have no chance to disempower the enemy.
Oh, right now, it'll be a little bit of tier 3 damage, almost insignificant, as tier 2 up towards top is going to be dropped. Disruptor, of course, is the first one to teleport back. Glimpse Vision, is it there? And is the range there? It seems like neither are there, so Sioma, unfortunately, is not going to find his pick off this time. However, what they do find is Mag, Hookshot, over towards the creep wave. PyCat has a blink and Mana Void. Can he get it off in time? Oh! Heard the noise, man, heard the noise, but the stun didn't quite come out in time, and Mag is able to make his escape.
Yeah, unfortunately, the hookshot's gonna hit PyCat on the way through. So that mini stun just enough to allow Mag to escape there. But either way, I mean, like I said, they're delaying out this Aegis timer. There's 2 minutes left on this Aegis on the gyrocopter. They've only lost a tier 2 top lane and one death on the Anti-Mage, albeit in the duration of this. But it feels like 4CL's game is going according to plan for them.
It is in darkness right now. Saxa has the gem, though no ag, so... Oh, Bambo. Curing back again. Just caught solo with it, but that's not exactly what he wants. Now Niqua's in a little bit of trouble. He'll blink away, but he'll get yanked right back, canceling his TP as well. Better hope that surge is enough, dude. He's gonna get a really nice wall down, but it's not gonna do enough up against all these heroes. Call down is gonna be in celebration as they take down two of the most important teamfight heroes from Four Clovers. Now, not only the tier 2s are exposed, but if they're able to, if the tier 2s wasn't there, then up the high ground, they could go easy to tier 3 and maybe even easy racks off of this if they had more damage, perhaps. But these are heroes that Four Clovers can't afford to lose. Like, the Anti-Mage is important, but given his farm rate, you can afford to lose him a couple times. You cannot lose your RP wall. That's what's keeping Vega out.
Yeah, so I think they're aware that Darkseer has no buyback as he drops his wall. So I would assume they poke at high ground, maybe. But now they'll see PyCat bottom lane, and they're immediately going to TP towards mid, perhaps looking to flank him. EGM is mid lane as well, and he's in glimpse range because of the creep wave. So EGM is forfeit here. No way he TPs out at Nether Toxin doing work, and they continue to find these kills for Vega. So if this happens the way it's been happening for the next 8 minutes or so, it feels like they can probably take a lane of Rax. The only difference is Aegis is expiring in 20 seconds, so 4CNL definitely aware of that timing. And if that's the case, they probably could take a fight here. If they're able to eliminate that Static Storm early with Bambo, it's going to definitely bode well for their chances.
I mean, Vega are peaking out at about this stage. It's only going to be more difficult from here on out, so they really have to make some big action happening. It is going to be a really, really short respawn. So for Vega's aggressive game plan, game kind of favoring them with the RNG roll.
Yeah.
Four Clovers,
Gaben
though.
Gaben doesn't like it.
Gaben wants to remove it. He trumps Ice Frog. If he pulls the plug, he pulls the plug. PyCat does have his Manta style, but it seems like, as good as an item as that is, what he really wants is the ultimate orb, because every single time he's died, it's been because of Sioma's Disruptor. Just getting the glimpse back, and Manta style doesn't exactly help you there.
Indeed. Aghanim's up onto Meg. So that hookshot, maybe just that 12 second cooldown. And he'll be able to utilize that very well, perhaps to cancel a death ward after the initiation going in. So it's a nice item pickup for them. They're going to have a Hyperstone up on their Manta.
Smoke.
No one. As well, but yeah, smoking off of RP here. They do not have Pycat though, so once again, just looking to delay out the game. They're gonna get Vision top lane of Solo's Tusk, and now he's gonna be joined by Pasha. This could be a huge RP for Bamboo, but they're gonna be pincered in from the south as well. Solo's gonna jump forward, they'll get Crippling Feared immediately. The hookshot will find Bamboo, that's the target they want. Mag's gonna be able to be skewered back, however, and Bamboo's gonna be forcing himself out to base, but they get EGM. They get Saxa and they get Niqua on the west side. Meanwhile, though, with the Manta style, Pycat pushing in their base. Tier 3 down to about half HP. Mag's going to be back. There's no one else TPing, though, and Pycat standing on the front lines. No mana on this Clockwork. Is he going to die for this? Yeah, I mean, maybe not enough of a mana pool for the Clockwork to go in, but Pycat still undeterred from this bottom lane. It's going to continue to fight into that Tier 3. Will now finally blink out. TP will be canceled by the Disruptor. He sees that with the creep wave. He'll blink forward, he's got the Mana Void available, he'll dunk the Clockwork, he gets the Tier 3 as well, he's continuing to chip away, he's going for the Range Racks, the Tier 3 hasn't even fallen
Solo
yet.
Solo can't stop him either, Solo's gonna teleport in, he better cancel that, he's gonna snowball, he's gonna pull out everything he has, but in the meantime, Bamboo, he caught Pasha on the backswing with the Death Ward there, BKB is gonna be popped right now, Death Ward not doing nearly enough, EGM will fall on Bamboo's big ultimate tool, now down though, Saxa is going to arrive, Raxes have already fallen in the mid lane, Raxes will fall over in the bottom lane, it's range for range so far. Can anyone bring down these melee racks? Niqua blinking in for a vacuum, but he gets ganked back. Pycat still doesn't have much to fear right now. As long as he has Vlad's to lifesteal, he will be fine. Someone else has to come here because Solo is completely tapped out of mana. He can Walrus Punch once, do a lot of damage, but not nearly enough. Slowly but surely, the rest of Vega are being routed over in mid.
Pycat has a Manta. Melee racks. Yeah, they're not going to be able to make it back in time.
Full lane racks
taken bot lanes. Pycat's going to get snowballed. No mana left onto Solo. He'll be able to blink to the south. He's going to TP away. There's going to be nothing to cancel it. And 4CL, they're able to take the advantage here.
That was a ballsy trade from Pycat, man, to say the least. Like, you leave your base to your teammates. Okay, we know that you don't have much damage as the four of you, but you guys can hold for a little while. And for Vega, I feel like that could have been stopped if you just send in a couple of different heroes. Like, Mag, once he's out of mana, is completely and utterly useless. Solo's not that much better. So, yeah, Pycat just doesn't have anyone to fear at that stage. So, ultimately, it is range Raxes to fall over in the mid lane, but Vega lose an entire lane of Raxes. And I think the scariest thing is that you could easily see that happening again up on top lane. There's still tier 2 mid, but for the anti-mage, the game plan, just keep on going. Never stop pushing, never stop slip pushing, because clearly they have to spend at least two heroes if they want to kill you off.
Fireside gonna draw some lines in the secret shop here and look to find a rotation. The courier is here. Pycat, no vision though. The Radiant Vision is up on the cliff and we'll scout him very soon. Mag gonna go for a hook onto the creep wave, expecting it to be there, but yeah, it's actually 12 second cooldown, so just keeping this creep wave at bay, trying to blow it up. They'll be able to do so. They're definitely now respecting the split push capabilities from the anti-mage on 4CL side, and yeah, getting those last hits on the racks is gonna be a big influx of gold for Pycat as well. He's got a 10 second BKB on this anti-mage. Mag.
Oh, and he has an angle on Mag. With Iron Shell on, Mag is
pops,
yeah, Mag's gonna smell something and he will leave. He'll see something, rather. Yeah. But for Vega, I think these lanes of Raxes for Forklobes in the bottom lane is gonna be such a hassle to deal with. Like, Pasha can clear a wave of super creeps like nobody's business. Everyone else from Vega will really, really struggle. Like, the Tusk can eventually do it. Tsioma can never really. Mag might need to, like, two hookshot the wave or, like, double flare the wave, which is fine, but it takes a really long time. They will secure themselves another life, however, should be grabbed by this gyrocopter, drop a TP for. Do you even want to drop a TP? You need the TP to deal with the anti-mage. They're gonna give it to the Viper instead, who has an item slot. I mean, Vega, they're still kind of in where they want to be, like where they're in a position where they can continuously push.
It's slipping away quickly.
Though. Yeah, Pycat eventually is gonna have to teleport back, especially since he doesn't have a TP right now.
Mag is in base though. He saw Mag TP back, so
Pycat, he's spotted with the shards. He'll blink over to the left side. Tsioma has a glimpse. He'll bring him back way too far. Now the Tusk is just a dead hero. No, it's BKB pops. Pycat is going to book it. That is 10 seconds down the drain, and hookshot is gonna land. Mag should not mess with this though.
I got excited there for a moment, but yeah, there's no one nearby, so just able to blink away, continue to split push. He's got Bamboo with the Empower mid lane, this tier 2. could be in a lot of trouble. Seema's going to TP immediately back to the base, in anticipating this flip push coming out from Pycat. They're going to glimmer in the disruptor. Mag goes for the hookshot, a nice anticipatory blink. They get the glimpse back though onto Pycat. He is going to be static stormed up. He's going to try and man up. Nice vacuum wall onto two. They walrus punch up Pycat, but the disruptor's already dead. They do end up getting the anti-mage. And Bambos utilize his RP. They need to get the hell out of dodge for Force Yell there. The hookshot is going to whiff. They do find EGM, however. And he actually is able to TP out underneath the gyrocopter. So all in all, they force Vega back with the Aegis once again, as they did the first time. They do lose the anti-mage though, which is a huge loss for them. He has buyback available already. Pasha up towards that mid lane, knowing the RP is down at these other four members of the 4CL squad. Have little to no kill potential on him with that BKB up. Actually, he has 30 seconds on the cooldown, so back out of this mid lane for now.
That was pretty gutsy of Four Clovers to actually go for that push, knowing that the Anti-Mage doesn't have a BKB. Again, every single time the Anti-Mage dies, it has been because of Sioma's disruptor play. If you get glimpsed, you have a chance of dying. If you don't get glimpsed, you're probably never ever going to fall. And well, BKB is just a say no to glimpse tool, and that one was not available. So they kind of find a break there. They do still have the double life here on no one, so it's time to go in and try to crack the high ground. 45 seconds until the Magnus RP is going to be up. 30 seconds until the Dark Tier is up, and well, they probably might lose their Raxus here. I don't think they can make a defense, especially not with Anti-Mage, and you don't buy back with 10 seconds left on the clock unless you're in a much more dire situation than this.
They don't push very well, though. With
it's
only
fast
no
enough, I think. Yeah, they still have 30 seconds.
So they'll get it. No RP available. There is a Glyph Pop, though. And they have Pycat a force staff. Maybe they can force someone forward aggressively. They get the glimpse back out onto Pycat. No one is going to be able to eliminate that melee Rax. He's up on the front lines though. Kask is connecting. The hookshot's going to find EGM. The Greaves are going to be early. There's a nice force staff surge combo. That's going to keep EGM safe for now. He's healing up with the Voodoo Restoration. Shockwave is going to whiff. Sax is going to go through. Gets the Crippling Fear off. The Manta is going to keep no one safe. He's beating onto this tier 3. Kask is going to come through. And no one's still staying on the front lines. Feeling pretty healthy. The RP is now cooled down. For Bambo, mid lane, they're going to go for Mag here. They get the Void and the Crippling Fear off. He's going to force staff himself forward. He'll be safe for now.
There's no angle for an RP, though. Like, best you can get. Oh, there's a good one. Oh, it's only going to land on one hero, though. It will end Sioma, so there's no Static Storm just yet as they do. But everyone pops BKBs. Pycat, in the middle of everything, gets a really late one. Gets a really big Mana Void. But Pasha, he's still at full HP. He's going to force Pycat to teleport away in the middle of the fight. Buyback here on the Darkseer. Vacuum wall onto three, yet RP only onto one. That could have been Four Clovers cleaning house, but instead they still have to deal with the siege.
Yeah, and Pycat held his BKB too long there. He took about 35% of his HP and damage before getting to pop it off. He will go for Mag, though. Yeah. And 2 seconds until a blink. You have vision on this high ground. He can probably bring him down, but he'll go for the disruptor for now. Pasha in a little bit of trouble as well. Bambo gonna jump forward. Skewer's gonna miss onto the gyrocopter. No one though. Up in the front lines is going to be brought down here. Vacuum will ensure that. They lose the tier 3 in the bot lane. They lose some damage on their range racks. Melee racks should heal. But they, as you mentioned earlier, miss a big opportunity for a team fight in it. If that team fight goes handily the way of 4CL with the RP actually overlapping that vacuum wall, feels like the game is just over.
Pycat has a lot of farm, but it seems like he needs like a basher or a butterfly or something really just to lay it in there. Because right now, the only damage item he really has is Battle Fury Mantis, which isn't bad, but you spent money on the Vlads and some extent on the Mantis style for defensive purposes. But the BKB especially, it really slows down his offensive power. And no one else is going to be doing the damage, especially when their ultimates don't layer properly. So Vega, they get a pretty big break there. They take the tier 3, they use the Aegis and don't waste it in the end, and ultimately balance out the Rax score. So it is the Vega and still in a pretty good position. They did lose a little bit of structures on the bottom lane. Tier 4 tower, none too healthy, but they'll run to Sioma right now. Pycat will at least. Glimmer, run away, Sioma. I don't think you can escape this hour. Pycat's going to look through all the trees, but Sioma's just right there. So easy kill eventually. TP is available, but with Saxa here, there's a 0% chance of survival, I want to say.
Yeah, Sioma, just going to delay this one out, but Casket.
Oh, wow.
Easy kill. And yeah, it's going to be a killing spree. 642 gold going EGM's way, so that's pretty nice for him on the way to his either BKB or Aghanim Scepter. He's got 2,500 gold, and that could be quite a bit of ramp up in terms of the damage. We mentioned before how Death Ward's pretty darn good against Corrosive Skin, as it more or less ignores that. Gyrocopter, not the greatest gets it as well, forcing to be built from that BKB. Does have quite a bit of armor, being an agility hero though. And evasion, of course, works against Death Ward, so.
PyCat is gonna jump on Solo because they see him from Sax's vision. They'll grab the Tusk, force the BKB up from Gyrocopter. PyCat may be stuck, but he's a blink out clean. And Pasha uses BKB charge for that. Is he even gonna survive? They're gonna vacuum him back. He does not have any defensive tools against this. The Death Ward's gonna be channeled. Pasha is on the run. Hookshot will interrupt the Death Ward in the end, but Mana Void cannot be interrupted. They'll take down the Gyrocopter. Mag is going to slip away as the Tusk is forced to buy out right now. Oh man, this is suddenly not looking that good for Vegas. They're gonna lose their tier 2.
But no BKB for 30 seconds. And
PyCat has his.
Yeah, no wave accompanying them just yet, but it now will join them in the mid lane. PyCat feeling very safe. He's got 4,900 gold. They want to hop over to that side shot, but PyCat jump forward. RP's going to whip. Bamboo not having a game today, but hook shot from Mag looking to counter initiate. They actually glimpse the enemy mage out of the cogs. They'll finish off the tier 2. Bamboo will fall, however. Jump forward back. He's not going to save him. And now Neek was in trouble as well. They have no gyrocopter for this fight, but they're taking it. Mag is going to get the hook shot off. Solo's been isolated on the east side. PyCat cannot jump in, though, with no one on the front lines. And Sox is going to be able to get out to the south. EGM will be the sacrificial lamb for his squad. PyCat in a little bit of trouble. Mag has the hookshot, does have a BKB though. PyCat gonna be just fine. There's no way they should lose that fight without the gyrocopter available.
Well, I mean, you kind of try to follow up on a Magnus initiation, and that's of course in quotation marks, because that is not how you initiate. Then Nikwa jumps in, lands the two-man vacuum, no wall. Like, vacuum is great, but it doesn't actually do that much in that situation. So the four clovers getting really, really antsy, and it was nighttime through the whole thing. So they should have played that a little bit more slowly. Wait until the Night Stalker actually moves up into the walls of the Radiant base to actually see who's there. If there's anyone there, if there's only a single hero there, you probably skewer them out of the base. You probably get that kill, and then you're able to go up high ground. But Bamboo making that all or nothing play was completely unnecessary and really cost the Four Clovers that fight. And they still do not have that RP for another 20 seconds. They will lose range racks down towards bottom lane. It looks like they may just lose melee racks as well. Bamboo's alive right now, but the Darkseer is not. They need the wall so badly if they're going to win this. Because this Rax is dropping super fast.
Yeah.
There's also no Death Ward Aghanim just yet. PyCat's going to jump right in towards no one, pops BKB, but he's not actually hitting a single person with it. He's going to hit like twice with it. They're going to vacuum back solo. Glimpse back is going to land onto Nikwa. PyCat's still charging forward, but now Pasha, he's going to pop his own BKB and just present a wall that Four Clovers have to run through. PyCat's not doing enough damage right now. He will Mana Void, grab a kill on the Clockwork. In the meantime, the Rax is still stand. The Anti-Mage now can turn around. Going for Pasha, going for Sioma right now. No Basher, so he's going to have to flutter in.
Nice.
They land an RP onto Pasha. They don't know it just yet, but now they finally do. Everyone's going to converge onto this Gyrocopter. Death Ward included. The Gyrocopter is probably going to die, and he will. He does have buyback. The Raxes are held for Four Clovers.
The first significant RP of the game for Bamboo after having a game on Magnus yesterday. 42 minutes into the game, it's going to come. And nice to see him kind of salvage his game thus far. That defense is going to give the Witch Doctor EGM enough for his Aghanims as well. And that'll ramp up their teamfight ability quite a bit. Despite it only being a level 2 Death Ward, the Aghanims bounce could be very nice. And I believe so that the bounces are not dodgeable on the Aghanims, so it's going to help against the butterfly of the Gyrocopter. PyCat, 2 seconds up until his BKB, is going to walk up to that high ground. And we'll be able to start putting some pressure into this tier 3 tower. Does have the BKB available, so Static Storm, not too worrisome at this point. 5 seconds till the Clockwork respawns, 30 until the Gyro. They do have the buyback on Pasha, but do they want to expend it at this point? Glyph is already going to be popped. This is going to be a tier 3 forfeit for sure. How far forward do 4CL want to go? Mag's going to look to initiate onto Nikla. He has the vacuum. They're going to force back the Clockwork. He's going to vacuum in the Viper, though, and pretty much secure his death. Glimmer Cape's going to be there as well. PyCat's going to jump in, trying to bring down no one, but
no
Glimmer Cape keeps him safe. Glimpse back. He's going to BKB it off.
There's an RP in 15 seconds right now. EGM in the trees will get hit with the hookshot. Shards will shove him out with the force half as well. PyCat jumps right in towards Mag. Snowball will pick them all up and PyCat will be just fine. Death Ward's going to be channeled. A huge Mana Void from PyCat's going to grab an instant double. They grab a triple with the shockwave as well. Pasha is finally back with no one, but the RP is there. Onto two heroes. Where's the anti-mage? He blinked out. They'll use the cast to stun them up further. But now PyCat's finally going to arrive. Cask's still bouncing. No one to fall and Pasha on the run. Blink, force that forward. PyCat buyback. Double buyback. Oh, I mean, it's a successful fight for Four Clovers. They take a huge amount of kills, and they force the buybacks.
Two buybacks come out from the Viper and the Clockwork. A huge loss of gold. Overall, it's going to be a 5k net worth swing in 4CL's favor. Ooh. It's going to be about 4k net experience as well. So things looking really good for them. They're going to transition easily into this extra late. And they're going to even get a Roshan for their troubles. No one's going to try and look to break down. But the Manta Illusions are burning all his mana. EGM's going to be there in the front lines as well. Bambo's here with his Skewer available if need be. And he's going to block the hook shot. Well played from Bambo. The Cogs are going to come out from Mag, but it's going to be too little, too late. 12 second cooldown is just enough for Pycat to buy time to pick up that Aegis. Cheese is on the ground. Nico will blink in and pick that up. And 4CL, finally, two fights in a row, we see Bambo with the patience and the foresight to be able to pick up a couple of RPs and Pycat more than strong enough before this pickup, and now with a full Abyssal Blade, doesn't feel like, he feels like any target he chooses is dead to rights.
Man, not only that Abyssal Blade though, but we got Aghanim's of course on the Witch Doctor and Night Stalker. Vlad's a huge item pickup on the Night Stalkers. Now Anti-Mage is a free item slot for a double life. I don't have an Aegis. I don't know about you. Magnus, I don't know if you go Silver Edge in this game, but he's absolutely loaded up on gold, as well as having the Darkseer with an ultimate orb going into what I can only assume is going to be a Sheepstick. So poor Clover is taking absolutely stunner of a fight, and Vega, they are forced to buy back, otherwise they lose Raxes, but they don't actually do anything with those buybacks. Can't really be assertive since there's no position to do so. And for Clovers, they're making this work. Anti-Mage is being just an absolute monster, but man, I feel like even though Pycat is definitely doing a lot of the damage here, I feel mostly EGM in this game who's doing the most work, at least compared to what you would expect from Witch Doctor. Of course, getting a decently fast Aghanim Scepter certainly doesn't hurt, but these casts, man, the timing on that and maybe the luck is he's locking also, down so many heroes for so long.
Yeah, he's also been the sacrificial lamb in a lot of fights and positioning himself well enough to kind of get his cores out of any peril. So Pycat playing really well as well. A couple of sloppy deaths, but only three to his name the entire game. Mm-hmm. They'll jump up to the high ground with that Manta style. The tier three will be forfeit here, and he's still got the BKB and the Abyssal available. He's going to take a lot of damage from no one here with his Basher, and it's going to force him out. They don't want to completely expend this Aegis early on. EGM, four levels in that Buddha Restoration, can heal him up. They got their Urn Charge on him as well. They'll reset. Wait for this next wave. The Aegis up. They'll still be able to go in here.
While this is happening, though, mid lane Raxes have been taken earlier for Vega. So eventually, four Clovers either take a fight or go back mid. They can't stay here forever. Bottom lane is pushing, I guess, but there's not much to lose there for Vega. So they can chill here the entire time and have a little bit. Oh, the blink is Abyssal, no one. Hookshot is going to come in, but the Mana Boy takes down the Viper. Huge RP in a vacuum on the four heroes. That's going to be a triple for Pycat, and that's got to be game. Bambo came out to play at the last second on that fight, dude. RP combos the vacuum wall. Beautiful.
I mean, we haven't seen 4CL communicate this well as they have in the past 2 days in the entire group stage, and they only lost one series in the group stage. Empire have got to be, I mean, as good as they've looked and as well as they've fared versus 4CL, they've got to be shaking in their boots at this point.
The poor Clovis heroes aren't moving. I can only assume they're hopping up on stage. Fortunately, can't see it from up here, but I'm pretty sure the pop-off from 4 Clovers has been practiced, and it is real because they just secured themselves about 30k from this victory. And yeah, going into a best of five after not only just beating Vega, but really crushing them, especially in the first game. But now this was a game that was, of course, a little bit closer, but four Clovers just ran a train all over this game. And Vega, they were in their comfort zone as well. These are not weird Vega heroes.
Yeah, definitely so. Extremely well played, as you mentioned. $65,000 guaranteed to 4CL sitting in this second place. And 125K goes to first, 35,000. Certainly nothing to scoff at for third place, but either way, Vega got to be disappointed with their play here. 4CL really asserting their dominance and not afraid in the draft screen at all. This isn't necessarily something they run all the time, but.
Pycat wants to finish it. He needs that last hit. Dude, you gotta get gold. Anyway, guys, I'm Mike Loris. I've been joined by MRP Dota. Hope you guys have been enjoying the tournament. Hope you guys have been enjoying the cast. Hopefully soon we'll be able to send it to our expert panel so that they can tell you exactly what happened in this game.